able to. We'd have no real union representation over there, and the company would have been able to put us into any department. They'd have been able to determine living levels. We'd have had no rights at all, and all the things that we fought for over since year dot, really, things like 32 and a half hour week, maternity agreements, all the things that really meant a lot to all people, but particularly the women, because things that we've strived for over the years should have been a lead for outside industries to come up behind us and negotiate the same things. And overnight, of course, he wanted to disband all of this. Mm-hmm. So it would have just been a tyrannical setup. I certainly could never have gone to Wapping under those sort of conditions. So.
When capital and labour quarrel, both sides suffer. But since 1907, strikebreaker Berghoff has made fat profits out of industrial warfare.
Since you've got no chance of doing what picketing is really all about, which is to try and persuade people not to go in and to, you know, to hand them leaflets and try and persuade them of your point of view, you can't, because what they've done at Wapping now, the main electronic gate's sort of there, they've now got that open, and there's another gate just beyond it that they've, you know, sort of improvised gate, so that cars coming along, where they used to have to stop at the main gate, they now whiz through, so that you've got no chance of talking to them. So you're just completely frustrated, you've got no way of getting your point of view over. So people do end up looking like a kind of screaming mob of people just standing there shouting scab. That people have no way of expressing their feelings. They've had something extremely brutal done to them. They've been sacked, just got rid of all the work that they've done for that company over. I mean, I was only there 5 years, but I mean, some people have been there an absolute lifetime. They've just been dumped on the streets. When they've tried to protest about it, they have the whole weight of the state thrown against them. The laws have been turned against them so that the union's money has been seized and we can't get any proper financial support. And there's no legal way of protesting about what's going on.
And as Liz said, during the miners' strike, I used to think that, you know, what they put over on the television must have been true. The crowds must have provoked the attacks. But now I know different.
I don't think there's been a Saturday night or indeed a major demonstration down there that hasn't been, I won't say slight bit of violence, there hasn't been really heavy undue violence. The graphics artist ran down the other week and he almost had tears in his eyes and says, God, I've just seen, I've just witnessed, you know, a young girl beaten up by the police. Mm-hmm. And I certainly say all the meetings I go to, see it, you've actually got to go down there and you've got to witness it. And there's incidents every single week. Myself, I was standing behind a piece of barrier, one of the ones that are embedded into the ground, and the police, I thought they were running towards me, I thought, well, that's fine, I'm behind a barrier, and they've just jumped over the barrier and started to hit the people around me. I just got out in time, and it was a snatch squad, and they just lifted people and put them into the van. There's these sort of things that are going on, and quite frankly, if it happened in South Africa, or any country where there's real, where there's a police state, or just a fascist regime, you would accept it. People don't accept it, and they don't believe it, because it's happening in central London, but it is going on. It's something I find difficult to talk about because I always feel I'm talking to somebody who don't believe me. But you've actually got to go down. That's the problem. And you've actually got to see it or be part of it. Certainly how I feel, very, very personally, is that I've always been a law-abiding citizen. As a worker, I've always, I believe, fought my way, acted as any reasonable worker does. And I feel that now I've been treated like an absolute criminal. And
I don't actually think that the role of the women in this is any different from the role of the men.
That's what
I think, you know, we're all people who've been sacked and it doesn't actually make any difference that we happen to be female employees. But I must say that there are one or two instances in this strike which have made me laugh because I've been going around speaking at meetings about it and I've quite often found myself on a platform with people from the NGA or fellow members of SOGAD who've said things like... mustn't forget that a lot of the people who've been put out of work are our lower paid lady colleagues and the clerical and the cleaners. And I thought, yeah, well, it's very nice to hear it now, but where were you, brothers, when we needed you? They suddenly noticed that actually there were people around in that building who were on low pay rates. And they never really noticed before, and I don't think, quite honestly, they cared. And I think that's maybe one of the things that will come out of this dispute, is that maybe a few attitudes will change, that they've suddenly noticed that, yes, you know, they did have female colleagues who were part of the union and are now out fighting for exactly the same things as they are.
And I think one of the things, too, that people haven't really given much thought to, and that is that if we lose this dispute, the country is going to suffer in terms of editorial content. And we do know inside that the pressure's building up on the journalists, and one of their main bones of contention is the fact that they draw up an article, and okay, before it would have been edited or adjusted. Now it's going in the paper, it's completely different to what they're starting off to write. Mm. Unless there is some form of control or somebody to resist certain atrocities that are put in the paper, quite frankly, that sort of thing can only go downhill. And if there's no union structure and if there's no control of what the editors want to put into the papers, then clearly over a period of time, the anybody but the Tories will have no real say in the economy. And people do believe what they see on telly and what they hear in the media.
We know the terms and conditions that those journalists have gone down there under. And we know that they've gone down, that they've done what they were told. They've accepted their £2,000 and their free membership as an inducement to go down. And I frankly wouldn't have the slightest confidence in anything that the Times would write now. I mean, I used to read the paper, obviously I worked for it, and I used to read it, and a lot of the journalists I had a lot of respect for. But not anymore, because I know the terms and conditions they've gone down there under. I mean, frankly, I wouldn't wrap fish and chips in the Times now.
Here comes the sun. Here comes the sun. I say it's all right.
To. There was just a clause saying that new methods of working would be introduced, and that just means that the employees, the people who actually have to operate these things, have no say over what they'll be doing. And I think that when that kind of new technology is introduced, it really is important for people to have a say in their terms and conditions.
He says he can work with limited numbers of staff. Well, fine, so he can. New technology has enabled him to do that. But the fact is they are working 40 to 60-hour weeks. So we would say that there should be a larger workforce as regards to the health and safety aspect that Liz touched upon. To the end of March, we know there's been 180 serious accidents in there. And, I mean, that just would not have happened at the old plants. So quite clearly, his disregard for health and safety, his disregard for anything that could possibly cost the company money. With the onset of new technology, we should be looking for shorter working weeks, and the employer should be looking for this, or lower age profiles in retirement, hopefully to offset some of the jobs onto unemployed, the younger age of the market. But clearly the bosses are abusing this. They want the benefits of new technology to streamline the work. Then they want the manpower in there to work, as Ms. Murdoch's showing, 40, 60 hours a week. So clearly they want it both sides. So.
Though I can see that, you know, that the new technology is coming, I don't know what the right response to it is, because I don't want to see jobs lost. And as you know, as Anne said, us getting no benefits whatsoever from that new technology, because you can just see a future when there'll be a small elite of employed people using the computers. And the rest of us will be unskilled, on the dole, and prevented from having a job by a massively increasing police force. It's all very well when people talk about progress and they say, you know, the unions are so this because they resisted new technology, but it's all very well until it you're actually the person that the progress hits in the face. And I mean, I don't know what the right attitude from the NGO would be in the face of that. I mean, do you take redundancy and say, yes, we'll just let all those jobs go? And that's in an industry which makes a hell of a lot of money. I mean, Murdoch made £47 million from all his four UK town halls. So you're saying, right, we'll let all those jobs go in a company that makes a lot of money. You know, the
see those jobs again. Murdoch's not going to invest that money here to create more jobs here. He'll just take the money off to the States to buy a television company.
I'm sorry.